Okay, we are recording. This is Patricia Cori, Beyond the Matrix, coming to you. I'm delighted to be coming to you today from the Azores, as usual, with a very special person who I have always celebrated for his wisdom and wit and knowledge and experience, and most of all, his ability to present information with the kind of impartiality that allows the other to find their truth, particularly true when it comes to crop circles. So I've given you in the text, you've got the whole background of Andy Thomas, because there's nothing more boring than having somebody read to you the qualifications and background of their guest. He doesn't need an introduction. Andy Thomas, I will say this, he's the director of the Glastonbury Symposium for I don't know how many decades. And you know, one of our leading researchers personally, he's my favorite researcher of the crop circle phenomenon. Again, because of that impartiality of allowing people to find their own truth, which is how I roll. So we're gonna talk about crop circles and God knows what else with Andy, and off we go. Andy, if you wanna add anything to that intro, by all means. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you my friend, Andy Thomas.
Oh, hello. Well, thank you, and lovely to be back. And yeah, I mean, the crop circles, I mean, you know, I mean, that these are things that wake people up, and you can argue about where they come from, as people do, of course, but whichever way you look at it, whatever the origins, these things, they make people think, they make people expand, and that's certainly, you know, that's what it did for me. And I think when you look at crop circles today and you realize it's still going on, and then you find new people who are getting into it, you realize they're still having the same effect. And the effect that it had on me was to make me realize that, A, there were things going on in the world that the mainstream were not telling us, and that, B, you know, potentially this was something which, you know, could change the world. And yeah, here we are. It changed my world. And now that's the way I look at it. You know, if it changes your world, what more justification do you need for their existence? So that's where we're at. And we're still getting amazing crop circles this year. And on it goes. It doesn't go away. I know everybody in the mainstream thinks it will finish long ago, but not at all. So here we are, and they're still inspiring. And I've gone on to a lot of other work and looked into the whole truth and mysteries realm from all kinds of angles. But it began really for me with the crop circles, and I still see that doing it for people today, and that's the wonderful thing about them.
Yeah, fantastic. You know, that's kind of what brought me to you anyway. I mean, I think I've spoken three times at your event, and we went into a crop circle with one of my groups once, and you know, it's just what I want to say about crop circles is, like Andy, you don't let anybody tell you what they mean. You know, okay, great, there's a lot of conjecture about the symbolism and all kinds of explanations, some very scientific and some very advanced geometric knowledge of the formulation of these things. But if you've been blessed to get into them, and like Andy, I've been getting into crop circles for 20 years, and some of them feel nothing and some of them blow your brain out. So it's important to be able to get into them if you can. And if not, you know, to study those extraordinary diagrams and see what you pick up. And with that said, Andy, I have to say that last year was sort of blasé for me. I wasn't very impressed with the formations. But this year, man, are we seeing some extraordinary ones. Have you been in any?
Do you know, as yet, I haven't. It's a strange year. Obviously, we've got restricted movement, like lots of places, and it's really weird. Although we've been in a kind of a lockdown, like many places, I've never been busier, just albeit with different things. And there's been a lot, I've been writing a lot about the pandemic. If anybody goes to my website, you'll see there's a long article there, trying to get to the core of what's going on, the many arguments, as you know. And I've been part of a group, an online group of people trying to discuss this out, trying to see if we can get to the truth. And that's actually eaten up so much time, but it's been truly valuable because we've all come out of it, I think, with an insight into the way different people will react to different circumstances. And the crop circles are the same. You know, you can have lots of different people and lots of different crop formations, and people will respond differently to each one in their own way. And that's the magic of it. You know, there isn't, I don't think there's one fixed answer or one fixed response you're meant to have. You know, like you say, I mean, last year for you wasn't so good. I knew people that were absolutely in heaven last last year. So it all depends, and that's the joy of it. No matter what angle you come at these things with, you know, there's something there. And it's the same in the outer world that the crop circle spin you out into. That, you know, if you start to seek for truth and you start to try to find a compassion for getting to a balanced understanding of what's going on, there's a lot out there, and it's not all dark and it's not all fearful, and there Absolutely. Are things we need to deal with, of course, but you know, there are ways through this, but you have to have the determination to do it. And with the crop circles, you have to have the determination to not listen to all the skepticism. Don't care what anybody else thinks about them. If they mean something to you, that's all you need. So, you know, that's the key thing.
Question of skepticism has probably never been greater than this moment, as we're battling it out on almost every aspect of being alive is in this polarized state of debate and argument and fighting and whatever. So I'm sure we'll be talking about that today together. But just before we get off the crop circles, I did want to say that, yeah, last year it just seemed there weren't, personally, there was the question of 5G possibly going live in Glastonbury, and that, you know, that was weird going on, and it was just a weird time. The farmers didn't seem so cooperative, but who knows? I was only there for a few minutes. Maybe that I caught a bad moment.
Well, I mean, one of the interesting things, I mean, by the way, I don't think 5G did get switched on in Glastonbury in the end. They're still arguing about it. But yeah, one of the interesting things about last year, 2019, was that France suddenly had this explosion of amazing crop circles. We, I thought, had some very good ones. But France, at one point, was overtaking England for the numbers of them. And it just suddenly had this extraordinary year. And it's had some good ones this year, too, but not so many. So you get years like this where a new area will just suddenly wake up with crop circles. And, you know, France had had them before, but last year it was the real bonanza year for them. You know, that's the thing. Each year it brings a new theme. It brings a new path to follow. And if you were living in France, suddenly they were there on your doorsteps. And somebody else, you know, they got the calling.
Wouldn't that be nice? Well, what does that do to your theory that you shared with my group back in the last time you were with me? Where you talked about the watershed and how all these crop circles, almost all of them, were appearing in areas of England where there was a high watershed. How does that work? Have you been able to analyze that at all as far as France?
To be honest, I haven't looked in detail. So for those that don't, you know, understand what we're talking about here, if you map out most of the crop circles of England anyway, but I understand this is generally true around the world, the majority of these things are appearing on the aquifers. So an aquifer is any rock that carries lots of water. And there's no question there is a correlation. And that makes some people think that whatever other forces are involved here, there is a natural component too that's playing a role, something geophysical in the ground. So when you look at the maps of the aquifers of England, and then you look at all the different crop circles, when you add them on the map, it's uncanny. There's clearly a correlation, because you come outside of those areas and there's very little going on, and it follows it almost to the letter. Almost, you know, even when the aquifer gets thin, the crop circles follow that arm of the aquifer. So I don't think it is random. So as for France, no, I haven't looked. It's a very good point. I probably should. So slap wrist for me. But these are the kinds of things you need lots of people out there doing this work. And that's why, you know, the more people that come into this and get drawn in, you know, the better. I mentioned a minute ago that new people are still being drawn in. One of the quite nice things is that younger people, having for years been told it was all explained 30 years ago and it's all a big joke, they're coming back to crop circles. And I mean, I did an interview, some of you might have seen it, for the Vice online channel, which is aimed, you know, at sort of younger people. And I did this crop circle interview. And, you know, it's caused quite a lot of interest. And yesterday I had a TV crew come round for, they're making a short film. And these are guys in their early 20s, full of passion and wanting to understand what is this thing. And they're rediscovering crop circles anew and realizing, you know, this was something that it felt to them like something magical from long ago. They're realizing it's still going on and they're trying to re-engage with it. So that's the thing, there's new generations still coming through, and it's changing them. And so that's the marvelous thing. It still has that effect.
It's just so exciting to see that. I just really, this summer, I'm just seeing some some formations that are triggering me a lot, and I can't be there, and that really cranks my core. Yeah. But whatever, that's okay. We're sitting here in this ridiculous confinement. We'll get through it. About the water, I just want to say that as far as from my spiritual interpretation, which I try not to put out too much, I still feel that there's something very electromagnetic about this fact that the water, the nature of water, is very magnetic, and that something very electric may be interacting with that. So in other words, pulling the magnetism of the water, all conjecture, of course, but that's how it feels to me. And so,
you're quite right. I mean, we need to remember there are different layers to this.
Yeah.
And just because we talk about water or electromagnetics, that doesn't mean they're not working together. And it doesn't rule out lots of other things, from intelligences to psychic forces. To me, I've always argued this meets in the middle somewhere. I think there's lots of strands of different phenomena all somehow joining up to create these formations. And it may well be there is something in nature which can create at least certain kinds of patterns, but something else is influencing that. It's helping them to create far more complexity. And whether you think that something else, therefore, is extraterrestrial, extra-dimensional, or us through some strange collective consciousness thing, in a way, it almost doesn't matter. It's evidence, I think, of something which has just never really been explained away. And that lack of a clear answer, on one level, I know it's frustrating for some, but on the other, it's marvelous because it leaves it open for everybody to come to it anew and just make of it what they will. And that's what's so nice.
I just wish that more people could understand that some of these mega galactic formations, like one of my favorites was the Tibetan mandala. Milk Hill, was it? I don't remember.
It was, yes,
Milk Hill. Driving around, and I, in my early days of being a crappie, driving on the wrong side of the road for me, and I coming around this hill, and then bam, this entire hill covered in this mandala overnight. And when you see that, it's important to get into them. But when you have that experience, knowing that this gigantic hill had this precision of formation overnight, you get a whole new perspective, and it's magnificent and huge, and it's really wonderful. So are you going to get into any this summer? Are you going
to? I would certainly like to. I'm supposed to be filming in the next couple of weeks with the crew, and we're going down to Wiltshire, and we're certainly going to hopefully find something there. So I'll be there. I mean, what I find today is I don't feel the need, as I once did, to be in every crop circle. There's so much in my life now, and my work so dedicated to truth seeking, if you want to call it that. You know, it's a part of what I do, and you can't do everything. So I don't even try to get into every crop circle, but I try to get into a few a year at least. But, you know, my thoughts on them remain the same, and I remain very, very enthusiastic and try to show people there is something going on here that cannot all just be a joke. You know, for every man-made crop circle, and we know there are some, that just cannot explain the whole thing. And what is going on, I think, is important and shouldn't be ignored. So, you know, I'm still very much involved in calling people to it. And I still write each year Nexus Magazine, which some of your readers may know, or your watchers, listeners. I write the annual crop circle roundup for Nexus. And that's an important thing for me, because I connect with it through that and try to give it context with what's gone on in the past. So, yeah, and I'm still very rooted in the crop circles for everything else that I'm also doing.
Well, you're an important voice for us, so thank you for dedicating so much of your life to it. Okay, so now, since you keep talking about truth, let's jump over to the fact that this is the first year, as I understand it, that you've done the Glastonbury Symposium online. It was just done, right?
Yes.
What was that like, and what did you cover?
So, well, if you look behind me, you'll see some of our old posters, in fact, which I like to keep on the walls here. So the Glastonbury Symposium, it's a long-running event, 30 years this year.
Unbelievable.
And I didn't begin it. I was there from early years, but I didn't start it. A very nice man called Roland Parger began it. And it began very much as a crop circle conference, UFOs, you know, all the kinds of related phenomena. But as the years went by, it grew to encompass lots of other things, because you realise that actually you need to look at this bit and that bit, and how does that relate to that phenomena? And before you know it, you've you've embraced many other things, and rightly so. And so over the years, we've expanded to look at everything from consciousness research to new physics and let's call them conspiracies, you know, looking at what we're up against and what we've got to do, deal with, which we do, sadly. So, you know, we got to our 30th anniversary.
Great.
And suddenly, couldn't have it, or not in the normal place. So that was disappointing, because of course we were really looking to celebrate, you know, in style, but it didn't work out like that. But we thought, okay, we'll do one day. We won't try and replicate the normal symposium, because being in Glastonbury, being in our venue with all the lovely banners, that's so much a part of it. But we'll try and do an online day one day that just keeps the friendly spirit of it. And actually, it went really well. We had a lot more people than I thought we would have, including people joining us online who've never been, because they've never been able to come to England. So they were now able to get a little bit of the vibe, and we kept the friendly style. And we, you know, for those of us that, you know, have been involved with the symposium for a long time, are old friends, and that comes across in the way that we run it. So we kept that element. We showed old pictures of old symposiums and various speakers in between the talks, and we just kept the spirit of it. And we had Rupert Sheldrake as our main guest. Wow. I mean, Rupert Sheldrake, if you don't know, he is, you know, the founder of the morphic resonance theory, animal telepathy, human telepathy, and looking at it from a scientific perspective. And he spoke at one of our very early events, but he hasn't been able to speak to us for quite a few years because he's normally in Canada in the summer. But of course, we thought, hang on, we're online. It doesn't matter, does it? So we managed to get Rupert to join us, and he was fantastic. Really, really good. So we had a great day. And although it's not what we'd hoped, and we'll do another celebration next year, hopefully properly, in our proper venue, assuming some kind of normality is back by then, it was nonetheless, it was worthwhile in its own right. And, you know, again, our aim is always to get conversations going. You know, people need to be talking about these things. They need to be standing against the propaganda of the media in every respect. Because we're told the world is small, we're told we're just flesh and blood, there's nothing metaphysical, there's nothing going on beyond what we tell you. And we know that's not the case, but we still need to get those conversations rippling out. So we did it in our own little way online this year, and hopefully back to normal next time.
Hopefully. I'm sorry I missed it, but congratulations. I didn't realize it was your 30th year. So, okay, yes, so here's the question. You said, hopefully we're going to get back to normalcy. And that is the question of the hour. I refuse the term the new normal completely. So how do you see this? What is your take on the idea of getting back to normal? We are now in August is the eighth month of this. So shall we just jump in and talk about the roots that are behind this?
Listen, yeah, I mean, let's just say, before we get into any detail, I mean, there's no question that things have changed. And it's an important moment in our history. It's not going to go back to exactly how it was, or not for a long time. And it, like anything, it's good and bad. You know, a massive upset brings things which you don't want. But when you look back at them often, you find it did bring new avenues of thought, new avenues of, you know, the way we live our lives. And that has been true. So for all the bad side of it, you know, there are people that have rediscovered themselves. They've suddenly had a lot more time. They've reconnected with family. They've, you know, they've suddenly found that their whole lives have been stress of rushing back and forth to work and doing things and all the usual things. And suddenly when that stopped, they were faced with themselves, and they didn't have anything else to fill their day with but, you know, themselves and their families. And I think, you know, a lot of truth has come out of that as to whether they're in the right situation. Some of it's horrible. We've had a rise in domestic violence here in Britain anyway, which is very sad, because people, of course, they're locked in together. But equally, other people have realized, actually, you know, we can reach out to people. Some were great. We had panic buying. I think you probably had panic buying, or wherever you are in the world watching this, which was stupid. But perhaps understandable in a way, because the media, I think, did stir that up a bit. But then after that, and everybody began to realize, okay, maybe it's going to be all right. People were out there redistributing food, helping elderly people. You know, the human sort of spirit came in, and there was a lot of good that we also saw. So for all the bad, and the big bad side of it is the control and the restrictions on freedom of speech that have now come in as a result of this. That's the very bad side, and we'll come to that in a moment. But there have also been, you know, positive elements to it. And if we can get the positive up to balance out what's not so good, we might look back at these times and realize that there was a value to them, however horrible some of it is, of course.
Leave it to you, Andy. You know, I just love the fact that you always bring it up to the positive side. Thank you for being that light. Pleasure. So, well, of course, one of the real positive sides is that nature, the planet, has gotten a break, a breather. And, you know, we've seen more humpback whales are being born, just a huge spike in humpback whales. For a while, when we were in total lockdown, we saw things like, there was a video in a street in Madrid where these peacocks were walking down the street, looking around like, yeah, where are the humans? What's going on? Yes, and in many locations, we've got animals, you know, wild boars. And I saw another one in Rome where this seagull was sitting on one of the statues. And you can read it. You don't have to be psychic to read that this bird is like, yeah, there's something not right going on here. This whole planetary lockdown and how the animals are reacting to it. Of course, you know, I'm an animal activist. So for me, that's extremely important. And how we ecologists are always screaming about the planet, what we're doing to the planet. And so one of the very good things that has come out of this slowdown, shutdown, is that the Earth has gotten a break. We seem to have had a reduction in chemtrails, particularly then. We seem to have purification of some of the rivers. Toxic human waste has been reduced dramatically. And I'd like to talk about that. And then, like you said, the upside, the domestic violence, but the upside of that is people interacting with each other with more love, like the Italians on the balconies singing orchestras, doing orchestras and singing O Sole Mio and whatever. So let's talk about that, your impressions about, first of all, the balance of the ecological situation, because I love I'm screaming like most people about a lot of the, let's say, difficult aspects, but I also keep trying to bring people up to how we're going to use this as part of the new Earth that we are determined.
Definitely. Well, I mean, you mentioned animals, and I think one of the important things was that, yes, not only did a lot of our activity stop and enable the animals to suddenly kind of interact with the environment in a new way. There's a lovely video, I think it was in England, of sheep getting onto a Charles roundabout in a play park and going round and round on there by themselves. Nobody was making them do it. So that was funny. So there were things like that. But also, we as human beings were certainly here, and here I am in England, interacted more with nature. And once they were allowed out for at least a limited time, and once we got over the days of all sitting indoors, people actually started to walk and go to natural places. And many people admitted they hadn't done this for years. But because now they were just so desperate to get out of the normal four walls environment, they were realizing that, you know, there is a real benefit to walking amongst trees and up on hills. And there are real benefits to it. I mean, you know, trees give off various chemicals and things that actually are very beneficial to us. And often we cut off from that. So people that are spending their days commuting to big cities and just spending days in horrible offices, very sterile environments, suddenly they were realizing there's another world outside of that. So I think that's been important, because one of the problems I think we have in this world today is that many people are cut off from nature, so they don't value it. And so when it begins to fall away or get polluted or be built over, they don't think it matters because they don't really relate to it themselves. So I think the more we can bring people back to looking at nature and realizing actually that we live in symbiosis with it, it's not separate from us. I think that's going to be crucial. And I do think that is one good thing that has come out of this.
Yes. And I liked what you said about not appreciating the, you know, it's there, but we don't appreciate it because we're so programmed in our routine of work and whatever. And now when you can't have it, when you're denied it, you start to really value it more. And hopefully that will endure so that people value more the fact that we need those trees, we need clean water, et cetera, et cetera, because we are seeing it improve so much. You know, I live on an island in the middle of the Atlantic, as you know, and we're seeing a wealth. We already have a huge kingdom in the ocean of cetaceans and other animals. We're seeing a huge increase. And I heard that there's an island some off of South America where dolphins swim all the time with humans, and that they're missing the humans so much that they're bringing, the dolphins keep bringing gifts from the ocean, pieces of coral and little pieces of whatever they find at the bottom of the water, and they're depositing them on the shore, like, please come back to us, please come, which is breaks my heart in a way. And in a way, it's also a good thing that humans are a little detached from being with them, so they can live their normal biological lives.
From that point of view, yes, I understand. Yeah, of course. So, yeah, I think, look, I mean, you know, like I said, there's been a good and a bad side to this. So there have been many good things, and like you say, cleaner air, all the rest of it. One of the potential downsides, though, so on one level, it's good. People are working from home more. They've realized, actually, you can do a lot of things that you would have gone into an office to do, actually, in your home environment. So it's less pollution, it's less travel, less stress from commuting. So that's good. But maybe the less good side is that of course, the more we're contained in our little boxes, as the old song used to go, you know, the more we're under constant surveillance. You know, every time we use Zoom, here we are, you know, that data's being collected. You've got the smart environment coming in. Everything is smart technology, which of course means that when your fridge, your cooker, your light switch, everything is smart. It's somewhere transmitting to somebody out there everything you're doing and everything you use and your whole lifestyle. And of course, the danger of that is that's open to abuse, never mind the electromagnetic aspect, because
exactly.
We keep surrounding ourselves with more and more EMF. And as we know, hence some of the arguments about 5G, of course, you know, many people are very worried about the effects of that on human beings. So that's the only thing. We're now going into a world where we're probably going to eventually, when this becomes the new normal, which you didn't want to use, but, you know, let's use their term. We will be, I think, a lot more trapped by technology, and there'll be a lot less sort of movement outside, and we'll be in potentially very controlled environments, and that could bring a downside.
So there goes the being outdoors with nature concept.
Well, that's what I'm saying. One of the good things is that people have reconnected. But if we now do this thing, oh, well, we'll all work from home then, you know, you may find people will simply begin to go out less. I mean, here, all the theatres are currently closed. They're gradually starting to try to reopen some of the bigger ones. But, you know, so you go out less, you interact less with people. Everybody's walking around now wearing masks. They're alienated from people. They're desensitized from
that's
normal
right.
things like facial expressions. And I understand on one level why they've felt they've had to do it. But at the same time, if it goes on for too long, I think there is a danger that it's almost a way of alienating us from each other. And that's a good way to control the human race, of course, because when you cut them off socially from each other and normal things just like touch and hugging and just being normal with people, when that becomes something that's frowned on as the generations go by, if this pandemic does not completely vanish, I think that that's going to be very dangerous for the human demeanor. And we could wind up rather more robotic, and then you're getting into the whole Brave New World situation, you know, where we're all sort of psychologically conditioned to just do what you're told and be in this very contained unit. So this is one of the things that I would advocate we become very aware of now before it gets out of hand. And the more people talk about this and the more people stand against the more, I think, excessive abuses of the controls that are going on at the moment, the more maybe we'll get a reasonable balance, because at the moment it certainly felt out of balance. And of course, many people in the more conspiracy realms believe this is all part of the New World Order plot to control us, and that they're of course bigging up the whole pandemic beyond maybe what it really is, so that they can justify these controls. And then certainly, you know, there is, I think, a legitimate threat there worth consideration. So we've got to find a balance. We don't want to get ill. I do. It is my personal view there is a virus, but I at the same time do believe that you know, it, the figures are not reliable. Many of the tests are not reliable, and we don't really know what's going on. And we should all be prepared to admit that, because at the moment, these statistics are thrown at us, which are used to control us, and yet they are not in their own right reliable. So we live in very uncertain times. And that's why, you know, there are groups of people out there, like the people that I mentioned earlier that I've been conversing with, we're just trying to cut through this. We're trying to get some idea, look, what is the truth of this? And if anybody's interested in some of these arguments, do go to my website, which is truthagenda.org. And there's a long article that I wrote there, not to tell anybody what to think, not at all, but to look at the arguments, why people question what they've been told about the pandemic, the 5G aspect, you know, what are the issues, so that at least you can get a clearer idea of what we need to navigate. And right now, there is an awful lot to navigate.
All right. Well, you said almost a way to control us talking about the mass. And I just, it's not that I take exception to that, but I think it's more than just almost. I think that, you know, when you turn, when I go into town here and we have no cases here, the story is when this all started, they said, bingo, we have five cases on your island. And they went into emergency hysteria mode. They cut off the airport, which is, by the way, interesting when you're marooned on an island in the middle of Atlantic with no way out. Small island at that, you can drive around the whole island in an hour, okay? So that, you know, that kind of puts you in a mood like, whoa. And they weren't they didn't allow any ships in, no ships into the harbor without quarantine. So we were completely cut off. Then the masks came in, the hysteria, you know, the plastic visors, the masks, the gloves, the fear. And, you know, somebody in an important position told me, well, you better get used to it, Patricia, because until we get the vaccines, we're all going to have to be like this or we're going to die. And I said, do you really believe that? That we don't even know what this virus is yet, but that there's going to be a vaccine that will save you from it when we don't even know how it's anything about it? How long are you willing to do this? As long as it takes. I'm waiting for the vaccine. That's going to save our life. And that is the mindset of a lot of people. So, yes. You know, back. I just want to go back to my comment about the almost controlled. And, you know, I turn around. Oh, sorry. I cut myself off from the flow of thought, which was for 5 weeks, 6 weeks, 7 weeks, they kept talking about these five cases that nobody knew about. And I dared to mention the fact that after 7 weeks, this people would either be dead or better. No. Well, we have nobody coming in. We have nobody going out. We have no ships coming in or out. So what do you think is going on here? Hmm. So then after 8 weeks, it went down to two cases. And they've started to let in a few flights. But it's so controlled and contrived. And it's pretty clear to see that this is an agenda from the EEC, because, you know, it's the same in every country. The figures, the numbers have changed, but the mandate, the dealing with it, masks and whatever, is kind of across the board. And, you know, the UN, doesn't the UN now call itself the UNNWO?
Well, I mean, listen, here's the thing. I mean, you're absolutely right. Fear is used to control us. I mean, if you look back through history and if you read my books, Conspiracies or The Truth Agenda, you know, I trace how fear has been used to control the population. And I think that's the worst thing about these times. So yes, okay, there's an issue to deal with. We need to be sensible. But when so much fear is spread, I think that has a very big effect on the population. And it's not a good one. In the collective consciousness, you know, it grips many people. And you're absolutely right. There are some people, they buy 100% the narrative that is given to them by the mainstream of fear, and you will die if you don't do what you are told to do. And the problem with that is, in the same way, maybe, I mean, we grew up with the nuclear bomb threat. That absolutely affected my childhood. The belief that at any moment we were all going to go bang, that did something to the collective psyche. And it did things to individuals. And now we've got children growing up being told this. Well, if you don't wear a mask, you know, somebody might die because of that. And it's like, whoa, just hold on a minute. Although I understand where the argument's coming from, there is a balance that I think's not being struck. But you're so right about the vaccines. So let's have a brief and gentle word about the vaccines. We know some people are concerned about vaccinations in general, but we also know that if you mention it, you will be deplatformed and you're worse than the devil. So that's the way the world's gone. You can no longer have a sensible conversation. But this vaccine, so the one that we're being told might save us all, is actually very uncertain. Because as yet, for all the claims of all the ones they're working on, there isn't one clear one that's come through which seems to show full success. And it's interesting that they're beginning to change the story now to say, well, it might be a vaccine like a flu jab that you have to have each year because it won't completely get rid of it. Well, many people are immediately suspicious because then a lot of money being made every year. And also it then suggests, well, it doesn't really work, does it? Because if it's going to change every year, well, then basically what they're saying is they won't eradicate it, but we'll all be queuing up. But you're absolutely right. There are people that I've met saying, the vaccine will sort everything out. Once we have the vaccine, the world will go back to normal. Well, you know, many worry about that vaccine. They're worried about what effects it might have if it hasn't been tested properly. If you want to go down the full conspiracy route, as we know, many people think that's going to be a deliberately nasty thing that you don't want to have. But then, if you do get concerned about it, you're accused of being an evil conspiracist, an anti-vaxxer, and you're taken offline. And you're not allowed to have a voice. And the killing of freedom of speech during these pandemic months has been the worst thing. And those that have tried to look at the figures, even reasonably, saying, are you sure this is genuine? People have worried about, could 5G be related to this? You know, even if you think they're wrong, and I'm not convinced that is the answer, but we should be allowed to speak about these things. But of course, then the mainstream and the authorities sell it that, oh no, if you talk about things like that, you're making people not obey our pandemic instructions. So you are an enemy of the state. And so people are finding that there is no free speech anymore. And that's now being extended out. So the boundaries have gone out and out until actually you can't talk about anything almost without somebody taking you offline. It's mad. And as a result, something like YouTube is now becoming a very anodyne platform, which basically anybody looking for the truth is no longer even going there. They're going to things like BitChute and other platforms that are now growing up. So what's happened is now words going around, well, you can't trust the mainstream anyway, which is the very thing they don't want. So by censoring so many people, they've actually alerted people to the fact that maybe the truth lies elsewhere. So it's all been self-defeating in the long run.
That's a good point. Did you hear about yesterday I've been shouting out about this group of medical professionals, doctors, who stood in front of a historical building in Washington, D.C. and came out and said, in no uncertain terms, that they have the cure. It's the hydro. We don't have to say the whole word because we are being careful not to be shot off the air. That Trump told us about, what, 4 months ago, the hydro and zinc. And now they're saying that that is the cure. I mean, medical professionals came out and said it is time the medical profession told you the truth. You're being lied to. Did you see this video?
Well, it's one of several that's effectively saying the same thing that are going around. But that's part of the problem. So much of this is going around. In the end, you don't really know what to believe. And maybe this is part of the point of these times. You're left snowblind because you just cannot trust these statistics, or there's a claim over there, but there's a claim over there. Who's right? You're then not allowed to talk about this, and you can therefore never get to the bottom of that. And before you know it, you're left, like a lot of people, feeling really deeply confused. So yes, this may be the cure, but if it is, it doesn't seem like they want us to have it. So maybe they want us to have their cure. But
they
who
do.
Knows? I think it's one of the terrible things of these times. People have been left just not knowing what information to trust. And that's what's so stupid, though, when maybe the kinds of things that, you know, we might talk about, we're the ones branded as spreading fake news, when all we're trying to do is have a conversation. And yet all the information coming from the mainstream, and I might add the World Health Organization, well, that doesn't seem any more reliable either. So people they don't trust, they no longer know what to believe. So it's all been a bit of a recipe for disaster. But I still believe that out of this some good will come. And part of it is that actually although the mainstream likes to think that it's getting rid of all these naughty conspiracy-minded people, what it is showing once and for all is that, you know, there is a wider truth out there that needs to be sought that they cannot and will not provide. And I think people are waking up to that now.
I think that the as far as people being confused what to believe, for starters, a good place to look is when you see a piece of information that's immediately taken down is your first clue at this point.
Well, or at the very least, it's actually going to make you more interested to know what that information was,
exactly,
isn't it? Whether it's true or not. So yeah, all they're doing is drawing attention to it and actually making you think, well, yeah, why? We had a poll recently because people have been tracing who trusts the mainstream news. And actually, here in Britain anyway, I think we're down to only, when they did these polls, only 20% of people believe what they hear in the mainstream news now. To me, that's a disaster, but they still don't get it. They don't stop to think maybe we're doing something wrong here. You know, maybe we should be more inclusive of different views. But instead, they just get ever more hard line with this very high and mighty view that anybody outside this small media bubble is ignorant or a bit stupid. And that's the very attitude that people don't like. And that's why they're turning away from the mainstream media. So in the end, the whole thing's going to collapse because increasingly people get their news not from these mainstream platforms, but from the platforms that they choose elsewhere. The only danger being that is that you do wind up in the echo chamber where you only hear people that agree with your viewpoint. That's the danger, because that can take you down cul-de-sacs, you know, in any avenue of thought. So it's all a bit sad because nobody's getting balance anymore. But I'm afraid the mainstream is very much to blame for that.
Well, we've got to also, one thing that needs to be discussed. Okay, let's, we can call conspiracy what it is. I'm a conspiracy realist, not a theorist. So we'll just feel comfortable to use that term or to express that. But it's important for people to have a perception of who owns the media and who owns the platforms. Because when you know that, I think it's what, 5, 6, maybe 7 big tycoons own the media, all of the media. And then these same tycoons have got their puppets running Farcebook. And I don't really know who runs the Tube. And I don't know very much about BitChute, et cetera. But
I think YouTube is owned by Google now anyway. So you find that, yeah, many of these different platforms, they're all linked in. No, you're absolutely right. There are very big, powerful people with huge influence and lots of money, and they do tend to pull most of the strings. So, you know, this is just an observable fact. And I don't understand why these days, if you dare talk about the ruling elite, you know, the mainstream try to shoot you down. Like, what do you mean? You know, that's inciting riots or anything. You're just saying the truth as it is. There are, you know, elites out there. We know they're very powerful. Let's accept that, move on. But yeah, no, you're absolutely right, because they have such influence. Basically, they are trying to create a matrix of consciousness that is trying to drag everybody into their way of doing things. Now, it works to a degree, but as we've just acknowledged, and maybe there's hope in this, it doesn't ultimately work. Well, not yet, because people are rejecting it. And that's why they're having to ban so many people offline and take them away from public view, because so many people are not going along with what they're telling them to believe. So yes, on one level, they've got lots of money and lots of power. But then you look at the figures as to what people believe and you realize that they are failing. Now, the danger of that, of course, is that they then have to take ever more draconian measures to control us. But the whole thing might just collapse in on itself in the end. And in my book, The Truth Agenda, I wrote about this. Don't ever think that global ruling elites or the New World Order are all powerful, because that's what they want you to think. The more you think they're all powerful, you give away your power. They're actually not. I think they're very flawed. I think they fight amongst themselves, and therein lies some hope. And I think they could easily make a big mistake, and it's all going to fall down on them. So, you know, let's see what happens. And the only way to combat that is to keep conversations going, though, and keep pointing out to as many people as possible that there are wider truths out there which are available. And you might now have to look for them beyond the mainstream, but they're there, and we can make our own minds up. Thank you very much. very much all you people at the top. So that's the thing, is to realize, of course, we are played like puppets, but you know what? You can cut the strings. You don't have to play to their tune all the time.
Starting by letting go of your cell phone as much as you possibly can and cutting out television. Cutting out the mainstream.
Well, or if you're going to watch what's coming out in the mainstream, just be aware of what it is and what their messages are. You know, do it with consciousness. Don't get just dragged in to think that's the one and only truth. But yeah, absolutely, it can have an insidious effect on the mind.
Although that there is most likely also subliminal information that's being broadcast out that people can't perceive consciously. I mean, a lot of people can't perceive the overt information consciously. So how are they going to be perceiving the subliminal? Right.
Yeah, no, that's true. I mean, obviously, the way they present something to you, the images they use in news, in advertising or whatever, they're trying to manipulate the way you think and they're trying to evoke certain emotions in you. We know this goes on. And it's an old trick. I mean, you can go back to printed pamphlets in the 1600s that were trying the same thing. But now it's far more sophisticated. But I think once you spot it, actually, it is clear to see it. I mean, I listen to the BBC News in the mornings just to see, look, what are they putting out there? And the agendas are so obvious. And now, I think once you wake up to it, you can't really be fooled by it. It's almost like you can't come back from that. And, you know, I almost laugh sometimes because it's just so obviously propaganda. So you can break out of it. The secret, though, is to always get balance. And the only danger of going too far in the opposite direction, and this is something that, you know, I have mentioned elsewhere, is that if you go too far into the conspiracy realms, you can find the same phenomenon. You can get stuck in one certain view, and they have their own tricks to play to draw you into their viewpoints. So there's a balance to be struck here. And just always ask that classic question, why does somebody want me to believe this? And,
exactly.
You know, who benefits from me believing this? So always ask that question and then just see where it takes you. But just keep your wits about you, you know, keep your questioning alive and you'll probably get through.
That is so true. When I call people to use discernment, the first question you want to ask yourself is, first of all, who benefits from it? Absolutely. And what's the money trail here? I mean, this business of this pandemic is multi-billion dollar business that, you know, they are stretching out. This could be years. And the sale of all these products, and we won't even talk about what the needle would include. And, you know, this is the first time I heard that that they're now talking about it being a yearly jab.
You know,
this is huge money. Follow the money, people. And then ask yourself the question, who benefits from this and who's behind it? And more, like you said, more and more people are starting to ask that question, which is great. And, you know, the books that I bring forward, the message is the tighter they squeeze you, the freer you become. Which is what you were saying, which is the bounce back aspect is you can only take so much repression before you start asking the questions. Like from seeing people here on my little island 4 weeks ago with the sheer terror to now, you know, dropping the mask and more and more people getting the fact that nothing's happening, nobody's sick here, maybe we can drop this. Because humans have a short attention span. And you can only, and I don't know if you'll agree with me, but I think you will, you can only hold that adrenaline frenzy energy for so long before it has to taper down.
You're so right. And we're seeing that absolutely now. So I can only speak from my experience here in England, but you know, yeah, people now, they're beginning to say, hang on a minute, if you look at the local figures, hardly anybody's got this thing. Your odds of getting it are so small. And yet, the measures they're bringing in seem to get ever harder here.
Yeah.
Instead of bringing them in when it mattered the most, when they seem quite lackadaisical about it, now they're bringing them in when it's clear there's not a lot going on. In some pockets of the country, yeah, maybe, but in many places. It's virtually nothing. So here's the problem. Of course, as your eye people are beginning to just drop their kind of controls a bit and thinking, you know what, I just want to get back to normal now. But that's when authorities have to bring in ever more fear. So now the big thing is, well, there's going to be a second wave. Spain is dealing with allegedly a second wave, and maybe there'll be a third wave. So you can hear them trying to come up, what's the next fear thing we can bring in? Because if we don't, we're going to lose control here. But exactly. You're absolutely right. People's attention spans are notoriously short. And already people are going, I'm just going to take my chances now. So I don't know how long they could keep this going. And hopefully there will come a time when people are going to say, you know, you can't justify these controls anymore. And perhaps one positive thing, I keep mentioning the mainstream media, but there have been some voices in the mainstream that have started to say this. Look, the numbers aren't reliable. You can't go on like this. You're destroying too many lives through what you're doing to the economy. There are voices getting louder, even in the mainstream, that are beginning to realize you can't keep this going forever. So let's hope that goes somewhere. But, you know, the worry is always that then the powers that be try to bring in something bigger, which will keep us all under control. And God knows what it could be next time, you know, evil alien invasion, maybe. But, you don't know what they might try.
Well, for starters, they know this works. So all they need to do is create a few setups where you've got people dropping dead in the streets, which we haven't seen yet. So if you want to take it to level 2 pandemic, we told you to follow our instructions and you didn't listen. And there's a scene from Manhattan. People are just falling in the streets, which could be a photo op. Or they could.
Yeah, but at the same time, though, you can only still do that for so long. There comes a time where, therefore, the powers that be either have to decide to just relax a bit, or they're going to have to kill us all. Which some, of course, believe that's exactly what they're trying to do. Personally, I don't quite understand the point of wiping out 95% of the population, because, you know, they need the money the economy creates to keep them up at the top. Do they really want to be king of a tiny castle? Probably not. But nonetheless, you know, yes, maybe they're going to start to do things like that. But there comes a time when people are going to go, you know what, I've just had enough of this. So I don't know. I think it could collapse in on them very easily if they don't start to just let go a bit. We'll see. But I think it might not go the way that they think.
I think you're right. So, folks, you've been listening to Andy Thomas. We're going to take a break, and we're going to come back to you with a second segment so that everybody has a chance to take in what we've been sharing. And I will be putting Andy's information in print on the information on the page. But when we come back, we're going to be talking about his book and the observations and wisdom that comes forward from that. And, you know, somewhere along in that part, I'm going to see what Andy thinks about Trump and the lowdown on QAnon and, you know, the good guys, bad guys paradigm, which I'm never into. I don't like the polarity of it. So let's see what Andy shares with us in part 2 coming right up.